Well, happy Sunday, everybody. This is Alan Arnette with a weekend update for our Virtual Everest 2020, supporting the Climbing Sherpas. Well, this past week, our fictional team was basically in base camp most of the week after coming down from their Camp 3 rotation. They're resting up. They did a day trip up to Pumori to high camps there. Got some awesome views of Nuptse and Lhotse and Everest, and they'd actually see the North Ridge coming up, the Northeast Ridge, where Mallory and Irvine climbed back in the 20s. So just an exciting time that this past week. And this next week is going to be the big week. They're going to be leaving base camp in a day or so, heading up for their summit bid. And we're going to see how they do. The big question, as always, is going to be the weather. So I'm going to be talking with Michael Fagan, a very renowned, very well-respected, longtime Everest weather forecaster. Going to have a video interview with him, and he's going to fill us in on what the real world conditions are like. The Chinese team on the north side is actually climbing in real world. This year, they're trying to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the first summit on the north side, but they've been stopped by heavy snow this year. So maybe it was a blessing in disguise that this season got postponed to next year. Hey, what's coming up now, though, is an interview I did with Ryan Waters. He's the founder and the owner of Mountain Professionals. I climbed with him on Everest back in 2008 and also in Aconcagua. A great guy, well-respected polar explorer as well. And you're going to hear us talk a lot about polar exploration in addition to Everest. So I hope you enjoy this interview with Ryan Waters. Hey, everybody, Alan here with Ryan Waters. He's the owner of Mountain Professionals. Ryan and I go far back in, what was it, Ryan, 2008, that we did Aconcagua, and then we went over to Everest. And that was a crazy year, my friend, because that was when China decided to close the north side, because we were going to go climb on the Tibet side. We were all set. And I was just looking forward to that so much, you know, doing the second step and all of that. And then China decided to close it for the Olympics. And so we were over on the south side, and oh my gosh, that was an experience. So how are you doing down there in Boulder, Ryan?
Doing fine. We're just like everyone else, kind of coming out of the shelter in place a little bit. Things are opening up. They've kind of moved to a safer at home is what they're calling it, as opposed to stay at home. So businesses are opening downtown, and but still doing curbside and things like that. So it's slowly, people are coming out of their caves a little bit. And but in Boulder, it's quite an adventure town. And so this whole time, people have been responsibly doing stuff outside. Like you see a lot of road biking and stuff like that, with people just on their own or in little groups of people. But certainly, everyone's really ready for things to open here, it's starting to happen.
I just saw this. I think this weekend they're going to be opening up all the campgrounds across the state. So maybe, you know, we're seeing a light at the end of this tunnel. So when China made their announcement, and then 2 days later, Nepal followed up with basically closing Everest, Nepal to everybody and China to foreigners, because there is a team up there right now. But they're having really a hard time this season with big, heavy snow that's stopping the Tibetans from getting the rope to the summit. But in general, what was your impression? What did you feel? Because, you know, you've been going to Everest now for how many years have you been going there?
Well, I first went in 2004, so it's been a long time. You know, I, like everyone else, we were hopeful. We had a good team ready to go, and everyone was sticking with it till the bitter end as things were evolving in the world, as far as our group and our clients. And as soon as China closed, you know, I could see a little bit of, this could be getting pretty serious. And, you know, when that happened, I think like other guide services, we also could potentially see the writing on the wall a little bit, you know, having Nepal follow suit. And I wasn't surprised. I was, in fact, talking a little bit with some other operators, you know, behind the scenes, and we were kind of getting each other's feel, like, what do you think's going to happen? You know, I don't know, you know, but so it wasn't a surprise at all. When it did happen, you know, we waited with our group till it was official, because you just don't, it got reversed or something. But, you know, and we were taking the approach of, like, if it happens, they decide to close it, then that's the decision and we go with it, and it's the right decision. But once it was official by the government of Nepal, then we went ahead and talked with our group, and you know, we're really lucky. We tend to have a pretty tight-knit group often on these big mountains. Often it's people that have climbed with us a lot. And so that was really helpful in this scenario where I could like literally just pick up the phone or write to our team individually and say, hey, this is what's happened. And all of them understood and they agreed that we'll just push until the following spring. And so our whole team is still going on the next expedition. And so we were really fortunate with that, you know, maybe some different companies that tend to have larger groups, that it was probably a little more chaotic when it comes to trying to get everyone sorted and things like that. So we were fortunate from that side. Our team was really supportive and they all understood and just said, hey, you know, just keep us up to date as to any developments. And so, yeah. We had a pretty transition when it comes to that.
So that's been a pretty common reaction, I think, from most of the clients, the members, that, you know, this stuff happens and sometimes it's just, you know, you've got to go with the flow, even though you've been training for a year and you got your body at the peak shape and all of that. But the Sherpas, on the other hand, and that's why we're doing this entire virtual Everest coverage and trying to raise money for the climbing Sherpas, you know, they're out. You know, I was talking to Tindy Sherpa on Tuesday, and he said that he had lined up 400 people between yak drivers and porters. And I mean, you know, this whole infrastructure. So when you think about the impact, it's huge. So what about your Nepali family and your team over there? How did they take it and how are they doing?
Yeah, they're good. Thankfully, we all of our guys are either in their villages or in Kathmandu. A lot of the climbing Sherpas live in Kathmandu nowadays, but they're all good. They're either at home or just doing what everyone else is doing there, just kind of passing the time. You know, one note on this whole project, it's been really amazing to see the response, and we appreciate you putting this together. And you know, it was a good outlet for us to do a fundraiser to help support our guys that work for us. And in fact, I was just talking with my partner Nepal, who runs all of our logistics, and we're about to send the first wave of all the funding to the families.
Oh, great. Actually.
So that's good, you know, getting that directly on the ground in the hands of the families, and just to help tide, you know, make the bridge past this season. And summer will be slow for them, of course, but then fall, you know, the boys may have some opportunities to get work. And so we certainly appreciate it. And they're all good and eager to get back out on a trip. I mean, we've been talking about, you know, some other additional programs and stuff, and my guys are all like, yep, let's do it, you know, because they want to get back on expeditions. They love doing it. They like working with people, and they love to be up in the mountains and work, and our cooks and everyone else. We're psyched to get back out there, and hopefully it happens sooner than later.
So we'll talk about some of your other trips in just a second. But so today is Sunday, May 17th. We're close to the end of the season, only a couple more weeks until the Nepal side basically shuts down due to the monsoons and the icefall melting and icefall doctors, you know, with the route and all that. So what would Ryan Waters and mountain professionals be doing on Sunday, May 17th on Mount Everest?
Yeah, like all the other people up there, we would be, I would imagine, just maybe getting into camp two, hopefully on a summit push. You know, we've had a lot of good success in the past years with that kind of, you know, May 18th through 24th kind of time window. And so this is the time where we would be, having gone through a little bit of stress looking at weather windows.
Yep.
And then arriving probably to camp two right now to take a rest day and kind of do final things and eat a bunch of good food and then be looking towards camp three. And so this is the time right now. It's like the sweet spot as far as weather goes. And we would be up there. And, you know, we're certainly missing that time with our group because we have a lot of good folks on this year's trip that we've climbed a lot of mountains with, and we know they were working for a long time to get in position for this year. And so, you know, it's tough, but like we've talked about, everyone understands, and, you know, hopefully they're going to be a year more prepared next year. And we'll be looking at this time next season, though. hopefully we're in camp two or camp three at this point and kind of looking for the top.
You know, different guides have different philosophies, expedition leaders, on when they go. You know, some, it's like Willie Bittingus, he'll have to be the first one. In fact, for a long time, he was with the rope fixers. And then Dave Hahn was famous for waiting till like the last day to go up. Did you have a philosophy? Do you have a philosophy on when, in terms of timing? Like you said, the sweet spot is really from like the 18th to the 22nd, 23rd. Did you have a philosophy of when you like to go?
Yeah, we're kind of in that zone where we like to wait for the first wave or two to kind of funnel through. I'm not a big fan of chasing the rope fixing team up the mountain.
Yeah.
It can work out in your favor and maybe you get home early, but to me, there's a little bit too many unknowns with that. And so we like to kind of wait for a wave or two, and we have a really good weather forecaster that we've used for a long time. And so we really believe in that. And it tends to be this kind of time zone where, you know, and that was part of the interesting thing last year with all the big, right, is that we didn't really get that. We had a very early window where the rope fixers were able to get up, but then it kind of closed down for a while. And that created this compression of teams. And so we typically don't see that in a normal year. And we like to watch some of those teams go through and get through the second wave and even third wave. And then we'll get up there and have like much less people and beautiful weather. And so, yeah, we're kind of in that, let's wait a little bit. I do agree. I know some people that like to wait till the bitter end, and I wouldn't say those, because then people get too, they start going stir crazy at base camp, watching other people go when they want it. What are we waiting for? So you kind of have to front load it and have good meetings, good communication, and just let people know, hey, this is kind of when we like to pursue that summit attempt. And so just keep it in your mind that we're going to be like looking at that that time range after usually the 18th of May.
So the as we begin to wrap this up, I just want to do something a little bit different. I want to talk about Mountain Professionals is kind of a unique, as you call yourself, a boutique guide company, seven summits plus the poles. I mean, you personally have done some amazing things on both of the Earth's poles, and crossing Antarctica and Greenland and the North Pole. And I mean, just some astounding achievements. I mean, you're up there in the record books. So you run trips to the South Pole and to the North Pole. So let's talk a little bit about and describe also this something called the Adventure Grand Slam. And I'd love for you to take a couple of minutes and just talk about comparing these polar expeditions to an Everest expedition.
Yeah, you know, it is surprisingly, there's a lot of skills and experience that translate between the two. But more surprisingly to a lot of people that have done a lot of mountaineering, it's actually quite different to ski to a pole, because the environment is unique in that, mountain climbing trips, especially high altitude where you're going up and down, you kind of go do a day of hard work and come down and rest again. And you kind of decompress and eat food at a base camp and all this stuff. Whereas polar expeditions are this like linear path every day. You're skiing and doing the same thing over and over. And so we've found that as a lot of people that are out to do seven summits or just climbing expeditions, when they want to go into skiing to a pole, for example, it's good to get some polar ski training and really learn about that environment, because it is different layering systems and just systems in the tent and how you get up and get on skis and all that stuff. And so having the experience personally, it helps a lot when you're guiding people, not only in the instruction side, but also, you know, you have, just like mountain climbing, the expedition leaders that you see out there and a lot that have been on your site on this project, right? It's people that have been around a long time, and there's a reason why they're leading Everest expeditions, because they have time in the mountains, and you get judgment and learn what's usually good decisions versus bad decisions. And it's the same on polar expeditions. And so time on skis is where you get that experience, and then you can take people with you to the poles. And so, yeah, that's one of the things we like to position ourselves as is, unique in that we, as this kind of Grand Slam thing rate gets higher and higher in popularity, is we want to be able to take people not only on the climbs, but also on the polar ski trips. And so that is unique with us, because some of the other operators may be more pigeonholed. They're either polar ski expedition guides or they're mountain climbing guides. Whereas we have kind of a couple people that are fluid in those two, and that's pretty unique in the world. There's not many people that guide both of those kinds of expeditions. And so,
and the Adventure Grand Slam is doing all the seven summits plus doing the North Pole and the South Pole. I guess it's the last degree. Does that count? You don't have to go starting at the ocean.
More and more, it's that people are using the Explorer's Grand Slam as the kind of tagline, and that it's kind of evolved into last degrees on the poles. Okay. 10, 20 years ago, it was something different. It was a little bit more full length trips from the land to a pole, and that's what I did, is do full length trips to the poles. So, you know, but it's great for us. We get to take people on the last degree ski trips, and we do full. In fact, I guided a full length ski trip last year. I've done it a few. So we do get people that are interested in the full length trip. It just seems that more and more, you know, time and money and all that stuff, sometimes it's a little bit easier to bite off a last degree ski trip as opposed to a full.
When you do one of those complete traverses or even the last degree, and this is a hard question, but is it tougher physically or mentally?
You know, it's a funny question. I remember a guy that I knew that worked down in Antarctica, and I had heard him say he thought a last degree trip to the South Pole was harder than an Everest trip. And when I first heard that, I kind of chuckled to myself. I was like, there's no way, like Everest is harder. But honestly, after I've guided more last degree South Pole trips, I think there's a lot of some truth in that, you know, Everest is hard, of course, we all know that. But with all this, there's a lot more support and day-to-day carrying of equipment, and just like the guiding has evolved so much over the years that it's become a little bit more accessible to a wider range of climbers. Whereas South Pole, skiing into the pole, you know, it's like 8 days of, you may be skiing for 6 to 9 hours every day. And it's a difficult environment. It could be minus 40 with wind chill. And so it's difficult. And it's a very much more condensed expedition than like Everest would be, but difficult in its own right. And so, they're tough, but they're really amazing accomplishment for people to do. And it's such a unique thing that it's very special, you know, to get one of the poles.
It's kind of
a different kind of category, right? Something, so it's cool.
Kind of interesting. We've talked a lot that Antarctica is just such a special place. I just love it to death. Yeah. I'd love to go back, and I'm not sure I'd ever do the last degree. I'm just not a skier, don't have an ACL, but I have been fortunate enough to climb with two great polar explorers back in, was it 98, 99 on Choil U with Borge Osland. And then of course with you on Everest and Aconcagua. Okay, Ryan. So let's wrap up here. I'll give you the last word. Any closing thoughts for the, you know, climbing Sherpas, the climbing community? Oh, maybe also just a mention or two about what your plans are. I think you're still trying to hope to go to Kilimanjaro, maybe Elbrust in 2020, but you know, who knows, right?
You know, for the main thing, the Everest season, we're going to just focus on next spring, not try to do anything in the fall. We're just concentrating on our other programs. Hopefully late summer stuff happens, you know, even Denali, which we know was canceled in this spring, is over, and even Rainier trips are now kind of in question. And so we're talking to the Rangers there. And so everything's up in the air, but we'll see. We have Carson's Pyramid trips in October, and that's been a question as well, just because of the political.
But apparently
gotten better. So Everyone's kind of sticking with it and just kind of hoping for the best. We get emails from our team members and they're like, what do you think? And, you know, we tell them as much as we can. And we're just kind of working on the policies right now. If people want to go on trips, you know, what can we do to really make them feel comfortable with regards to, you know, deposits. And since it's a fluid situation, we're just working with everyone to try to keep the dream alive. You know, it's good to have the goals and be psyched to go to these trips. And I know a lot of people want to get out and do it. So we'll just try to do it safely and without the waves of signing up and then having to back out and cancel travel and all that stuff. So we'll just work on it and see what happens.
All righty, sir. Well, I hope it gets back to normal sooner rather than later. And you get back on your skis and then on your crampons. All my best to the mountain professional family. Like I said, we go way, way back, and it's been a good time. So best of luck to you, Ryan, and we'll talk later.
Thanks. Okay. We appreciate it.
Take care. Bye-bye.